Hello, Australia. Welcome to episode 541 of The Couch. Hope you can stick around. We have got a big show coming up. Guide Dogs WA have got a beautiful event called Dining in the Dark. You're going to see my attempts. You're also going to talk to Jessica from the Guide Dogs WA very soon. Steve Collins has taken a trip to Malaysia on Malaysian Airlines. Yes, Malaysian Airlines. We're going to hear more about that one. Charlton's got all the brand new movies out in Australia and around the world. Can't wait for that one. Also, Neesha's coming in to talk about the UN, and Amber Reid comes in for a chat. She's also opening the show on the other side of this opener. It's episode 541. Starts now. It's showtime on the couch. Yeah, it's showtime on the couch. You can see it from your house. You can watch it from your house. It's showtime on the couch. With Fred and the best in town. Hello, welcome to Foxtel for The Couch, episode 541. Hope you can stick around. Big show. Amber Reid is a wonderful young talent. She's only 16 years old, just about to finish her year 12, and she's performing for us right here on set today. A beautiful song called Ave Maria. Here she is to open The Couch today.
Maria.
fantastic young talent. She's only 16, going on 17, Amber Reid. I'm going to have a chat to her very soon, so stay tuned. And she's singing a beautiful song at the end of the show. And she's a big fan of Christina Aguilera as well. All right, I'm a big fan of movies, and I went to see one which is on my list today called Miss You Already with Toni Collette. And today to talk movies is our very own Charlton Hart. Welcome back.
Thank you very much.
Now, you're filling in for Cameron today, who's in Hong Kong.
Yes. So unfortunately, you're stuck with me again this week.
Oh, what can we do? But I miss you already.
We told off the last time to keep it clean this time, so...
That's all good.
Let's see how it goes.
What have we got?
Today we're looking at three movies coming out. Sleeping with Other People, I Miss You Already, and Legend.
Three things you know all about. Legend, Sleeping with Other People, and Miss You Already when they leave you.
No comment.
Okay.
The first movie we're going to have a look at is Sleeping with Other People. Mm-hmm. Can two serial cheats get a second chance at love?
I don't know.
That is the question. After one night stand in college, 12 years later, two serial cheats, Lainey and Jake, discover they both have the same problem. They can't stay faithful. They make a deal to just keep their relationship platonic, but that proves easier said than done.
What's the secret of being loyal to your partner, do you think, Chop?
I didn't really think there was a secret to it.
Oh, you just cheat and tell everybody. That's what a great idea. Yeah. Nothing to be worried about.
Well, I'm an honest person.
Let's have a look at the trailer.
Hey, Hannah.
You're disgusting.
Your issue with me and
my best friend
is driven by culturally infused female competition. Can we please go home?
Dry each other off using friction.
Got a girlfriend, Charles?
No.
Play in the field,
My therapist suggested that I attend a program for love addiction.
No, listen.
Sam, I cheated on you.
Was it my brother?
You know I'm not attracted to your brother.
Who is better than my brother?
Of all the gin joints.
Jay.
Yes.
It's been, 12 years?
The guy I lost my virginity to was at my sex addicts meeting.
Were you just in that meeting?
Oh, yeah. Had to get out of there, though. It was making me super horny.
Hey, I'm on Facebook.
Weird thing to say out loud.
You're gonna have to explain this to me. I mean,
you're a catch. You got a strong vocabulary. You look dynamite in a tank top.
We just spent the entire evening talking about how we screw up every sexual relationship.
We gotta just be friends.
Okay, but then we gotta come up with a system.
We come up with a safe word if we're having sexual tension.
You pick it.
Avocado.
No, it's too sexual.
Avocado is too sexual.
Oh, yeah. I mean, you gotta see the way I eat an avocado. You'd be like, do that to me.
Will you take drugs with me and go to a kid's birthday party?
I literally thought you'd never ask.
Are you guys high?
We're actually rolling.
So that's how Henry was conceived.
Who wants to learn a dance?
Who's the choreographer?
Yeah. His friend Lainey, who he really wants to
get
like,
deep, bam. Deep up in
like,
there.
So she's single?
Oh, 100%.
Yeah. This guy is hooking up emotional real estate that could be occupied by a real option.
I'm Chris. This is Paul.
Are you really using your kid to hit on my friend?
Shut up. Ignore him. He's on drugs.
Are you guys sleeping with each other?
No.
Oh, good. Oh, my God. Good.
Do you want to talk about it?
Talk about what?
We're not a couple, but we act like one.
When you start sleeping with people, you risk losing. Never slept with someone I wasn't willing to lose.
For the first time, I'm a little bit optimistic. You might not become that creepy guy.
To virginity.
Yes. Naomi still has her anal virginity.
That's not true. A lot of guys have been up there, just not you. Oh.
Sleeping with other people. Mm. Well, I always think if you're going to sleep, you might as well sleep with other people, because who else would you sleep with?
Yeah, right. Written and directed.
Oh, you're good, Charlton. You're very quiet.
Thank you very much. Yeah, I'm trying to be.
Who's in it?
It's written and directed by Leslie Headland, produced by Will Farrell, Adam McKay, Sidney Kimmel, and Jessica Albom.
Great actors.
Stars Alison Brie, Jason Sudeikis, Adam Scott, and Amanda Pate, and it's out now.
Beautiful. What's the next one?
The next one is I Miss You Already. Now, this one's actually quite depressing.
We haven't fired you yet. No need to miss me. I actually watched this one, Toni Collette and Drew Barrymore, right?
Absolutely, yeah. It's two friends that, two lifelong best friends, and their relationship's kind of tested when one of them develops terminal breast cancer.
It's really a sad movie, I have to say to you. They grow up together. They sort of reminisce about when they were kids. Then they both are rebels. They're really... naughty people, I suppose, when they were young. Then they settle down and marry beautiful people, and they have children, and they become really decent people in the community, and then it's the cancer strikes, and it's all the way it affects friendships, children, husband and wives, all that sort of thing.
Yeah, it's quite a sad movie.
You may want to review it yourself sometime.
Let's take a look at a trailer.
That's a good idea, yes. Why not?
Too late for drugs now?
It's never too late for drugs.
I want Millie.
Who?
Millie, my best friend. We did everything together. While Millie wasn't always entirely appropriate,
she became a wonderful mother.
While I was still just an auntie.
Your eggs are ready.
Not according to this.
I didn't have many pictures that Millie wasn't in. She was always there.
I miss you already.
The lump is malignant.
Hey, what are you up to at lunchtime?
Is everything okay?
I have to have chemo, like, straight away.
Well, is it contained in my body? Yes.
Oh, Jesus.
Jess, this is Nurse Sam. Nurse Sam, this is Jess, my elderly companion.
That is a big prick.
I'm going to look like a mutant. Who's going to give a shit about me then?
Me.
Colour?
Something that matches.
Upstairs or downstairs?
Oh, Jess, you should tell her.
I just don't want to rub it in that my life is great right now.
I know everyone's enjoying this expensive meal whilst looking at my wig. No, I'm not dead yet, so let's drink to that.
Wait.
Driver, take us here, please.
This isn't the way home.
Think of it as an adventure.
Why do you suck me into this shit?
The sun is always there to shine. The clouds don't own the sky.
Mum, I'm going to give you some new bosoms.
Oh, a bit bigger, please.
Mum!
Come on, Franken tits. Let's get you bandaged up.
I really want there to be a heaven.
I think they'd let me in there. Not unless they've lowered the entry requirements.
I miss you already.
That's okay, you're not ready to leave yet. You forget, we tell you when to go. That's okay.
That one's out on the 22nd.
No need to review anymore, I said everything. It was a wonderful movie, and I'm not telling you who dies in the end. But someone does.
Spoiler alert!
Nah, it's a great movie, you've got to watch it for yourself. There's more to it than just people dying. There's a message there about cancer and how to deal with it and families, the way it breaks people up. Anyway,
on a better note, the next movie that we're going to have a look at is Legend. It's a true story.
Did you pick these movies this week?
Pick them this
way. Did you pick all the titles? Legend?
Oh, yeah, I'm a bit of a legend.
You with your sunglasses on Instagram, I saw you there.
Yeah.
With your new snap-ons, which you can't say anything about.
The film tells the story of the identical twin gangsters, Reggie and Ronnie Cray, two of the most notorious criminals in British history and their organised crime empire. Let's take a bit of a look at the trailer.
Just run and escape. Each place we go, so afraid that he might show. Yeah, run and escape.
Me and my brother. We're going to rule London.
These are the Cray twins, Ronald and Reginald.
awesome movies. Can't wait to see all your favourite movies next weekend.
Thank you very much.
Now, can I just say quickly, because I know you're finished, pretty much so. I've got these new glasses that you gave me, which I got them like this, and they're quite... I know we're running out of time, so I'm just going to show you. I thought they were broken when you first gave them to me, and I thought, oh, a lovely gift that you didn't want. So I think I'm doing it right now. This goes like that.
That goes like that.
Then you fold those out like that,
yep.
And then you put them on like that, and then you can actually turn the side, and you go like that.
Yep.
And look out for them, because they're coming soon.
Absolutely, and then when you're done with them, slap them straight on your wrist.
Yes, I want to show people that. So you go like that, and that normally is open. They're really easy to use so far.
You're not very tech savvy.
Here we go. Ready? You go like this. Have a look at this. Ready? I'm going to do it. Beautiful.
Boom. Done.
And it doubles as a bracelet.
Cutting edge.
Beautiful. Thank you for the gift. Thank you, Charlton.
Not
we'll
a
talk
problem.
To you later.
Thank
on.
You very much.
Now it's time to talk. I just remember. Sorry, Annie, I'm laughing at the glasses. Over to you.
Thanks, Fred. Today on KidzBiz, we have Gareth Henderson, and he is a producer and a vocal coach, and he's also started his own vocal school in Coogee, and we're going to talk about a whole bunch of other stuff he's doing as well. So thanks for coming on the show, Gareth.
It's a pleasure, Annie.
So you recently moved from England. How are you liking Australia?
I'm loving it. I mean, you know, to be honest, there's very little I've found so far that I don't think's adorable. I've been warned that I'm going to notice it's going to get really hot soon. I arrived just before the winter, so for me, your winter was pretty much the same as my summer, so it's
Ooh,
been
you're
easy.
In for
so,
it.
Yeah, I know.
So you're a singing teacher. How did you get into that?
I think, like an awful lot of singing teachers, I started the bad way in that I was a singer who'd had some problems with their voice. I'm one of those singers who I sing too loud. That's a common mistake, especially when you try and hit high notes. And I went to see a singing teacher to help me with the problems I was having. They managed to help me a great deal with my problems. I became fascinated with how they did that. So I started working hard on helping other people with their singing. 10 years later, I was still helping other people with their singing, and that was my full-time occupation. And I ended up finding out about a revolutionary, very successful method for teaching people to sing way better than I was doing at the time. So I then put a lot of time and effort into going to various places around the world studying how to be a better singing teacher.
So how did you transition from being a singer into being a singing teacher?
It's a good question. I mean, people often ask me, don't I miss actually being a singer? And I guess sometimes I do, but there is that point where I got to a place in my life where I was very confident as a singer. I'd sung in lots of big gigs to very large audiences, and people have been very kind to me about my singing. But I was constantly questioning whether or not I was doing a good enough job, and having put lots of effort into learning how to solve those problems for myself, you end up wanting to solve them for other people. Other people come to you and explain what goes wrong for them, and you go, well, I know a trick for that. And you get a lot of pleasure from helping people. I know that sounds really kind of sad, but seeing the look on somebody's face when the penny drops and they get it, and then seeing them go on stage and doing a great job, or sometimes seeing them going on stage and doing a really bad job, but knowing that you can put that right and help them and give them the confidence to go back and do it again, it's very rewarding. And, you know, I get paid.
That's a bit. No, but it sounds like you really love your job.
I do.
So what would you like to bring to singing in WA?
Well, certainly the method that I studied, I was very lucky. You know, the stuff that I do, which I wholeheartedly believe is the best method there is in the world of teaching singing, I didn't invent it. I was lucky in that I met some of the best singing teachers in the world. I mean, that the method was invented by the guy who taught Michael Jackson and Stevie Wonder and Kelly Clarkson.
Cool.
He's got 120 Grammy Award-winning pupils. And I'm fortunate that the method that he teaches, he taught other teachers to teach, and I've studied with some of the best singing teachers in the world. So what I want to bring to WA is certainly that level of singing tuition. There are a lot of singing teachers around the world, not just WA, who passionately believe in what they do, but really what they are singers who studied how to sing, who know how to solve their own problems, but they don't necessarily know how to solve problems that aren't the same as the ones that they've had. So the method that I studied was very much about, in some ways, analysing an individual's voice, understanding what their problems are, and knowing solutions to a range of problems. So I'm going to bring that kind of singing tuition to WA and make sure that we're giving people the best help they can get for their voice.
So as a singer, you're intriguing me with this.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm sure there's been other people who have wanted to work with you. So most important question, have you worked with any famous people?
I've worked with some people who have been famous and probably aren't famous anymore, and some of them have been lovely. Certainly there was a lady called Yaz who sang sang a song called The Only Way Is Up that was a hit when I was young. So I got to work with
Fred's
her.
Fred's nodding.
Yeah, there was so yeah, she's lovely. Nuts, but lovely. Sorry if you're out there, yes. a guy known as the Artful Dodger who was responsible for all of the Craig David hits. Him. Yeah, so he's a good friend now, but it was a pleasure teaching him. The person that most people know of is Birdie, who came to me when she was 12 years old. She was in a national talent competition, and I was actually her prize in my other role as a studio producer. So she came and recorded a load of early demos with me, and it was those demos that ended up getting her signed to her current deal. And I've been very lucky to have worked on some of the stuff that she's recorded and gone on to be successful with, which is how come I have my name on a triple platinum selling Australian album.
Cool.
Yeah.
So you work as a producer and a vocal coach. Yep. You ever find that they conflict or...?
They do. I mean, actually, in many respects, they do. Obviously, my job, part of what I do, is to try and resolve that conflict. What I mean by that is, as a singing teacher, you're supposed to always look after the health of your client's voice. And I understand that and I respect that. Yep. But sometimes the singing that's the safest can sometimes feel a little bit less honest and emotive than the singing that someone wants to put across in a song. Some of my absolute favourite vocals in the world are a little bit faulty. You know, they have to go a little bit wrong occasionally to show some passion.
Yeah.
So as a studio producer, you're looking for the thing that's the most believable and the most passionate. As a singing teacher, you're looking to make sure it's being done healthily. And sometimes finding the best compromise between those two things can be a bit of a challenge.
Mm. So you said you were starting a school in Coogee. I believe it's called Vocal Tech?
We've got a facility, so a building, that is both two teaching rooms and a recording studio in the same place. So there'll be singing tuition and a recording studio taking place. That's actually in a place called Yanjibup, which is quite near Coogee. What happens in Coogee is something slightly different. We have a group that's, it's not one-to-one tuition, it's a group for 7 to 18-year-olds who get together once a week and they learn pop, singing and choreography and put on live concerts. And that happens at the Coogee Surf and Life Saving Club every Tuesday evening. And that's a gorgeous place to rehearse because you're literally looking out over the sea.
Oh, that'd be beautiful.
Yeah, it's great.
So thanks so much for coming on the show, Gareth. Look forward to hearing more about everything you're doing. And if people want more information, is there a website they can go to?
There's a website for the children's group that I told you about that's already up and running. That's www.australianpopacademy.com.au. The website is just in progress for Vocal Tech, but that will be vocaltech.com.au, so keep an eye out for that.
Oh, they will. And for more information, go to thecouch.com.au. And that's KidzBiz. Back to you, Fred.
Thank you very much, Annie Kay. A wonderful segment. And next week, Annie Kay will sing for us on the show. So I'm looking forward to that, Annie. Very good. We'll be back with more of the show after the break. We're going to talk about dining in the dark with the Guide Dogs WA, Jessica, and more after this on Foxtel. Welcome back to The Couch here on Aurora Television Foxtel. I hope you're having a wonderful Sunday. About a week or two ago, I had the opportunity to go to Dining in the Dark, the launch that the Guide Dogs WA did here for a wonderful event that's coming up, and we'll talk more about that with Neesha. But I had a wonderful time where I had to roll some sushi with a blindfold on. I did admit to cheating. That's about all I'm going to admit to, but it was a lot of fun. It also opens the awareness in the community that guide dogs are incredibly important to people who are sight impaired or totally blind. Today, to talk to us more about that and Dining in the Dark and Guide Dogs WA is our very own Neesha. She's got some friends with her, Jessica and, of course, Andrew. And we've got Hilda and the other name?
Mitchell.
Mitchell. Thank you. Over to you, Neesha.
Lovely. Thank you, Fred. I'd like to welcome both Andrew and Jess to the couch. Welcome.
Thank you so much for having us.
And I'd also like to welcome Mitchell and Hilda as well. Hilda's doing a big yawn. Oh, Mitchell as well. So cute. So welcome to The Couch. Today we're talking about Dining in the Dark, a new initiative. But first and foremost, I'd like to know a little bit more about what you do, particularly Andrew, your role at Guide Dogs WA. Tell us a bit about your role and what you do there.
My role is Training and Development Manager for Visibility Guide Dogs WA. And it encompasses a range of different activities, partly puppy development, but also staff development and just development of the organisation and the focusing of the brand within the guide dog side.
Lovely, lovely. And Guide Dogs WA, tell us about the organisation and what you're here in the community to do.
Well, it's we have a proud tradition in WA, in Western Australia. We've been around for many, many years. Mm-hmm. We have a strong, prominent brand, and we are... ostensibly a client-centric organisation. We look at providing a range of services, one just being the guide dog and the training and the supporting thereof.
And you are largely or completely community funded, aren't you? So tell us a bit about the passion and the training that goes into producing beautifully trained dogs like Mitchell and as well as Hilda, who are still puppies but on their way.
Well, both these pups are in what we call the puppy development program, and they're raised by volunteers. Mm-hmm. And for about 12 to 14 months, they are mm-hmm. out in the public, and they have been positioned in this time to be a good guide dog. Mm. So what we're looking for at the end is a confident animal that will go into a range of different places mm-hmm. and accept a change in environment, mm-hmm. and then our professional trainers pick the puppy up or the young adult dog then mm-hmm. and develop it from there on into being a working guide dog.
Wonderful. And is it true that guide dogs are allowed to go anywhere?
This is correct. Principally that is true. There are some areas where there might be what we call rightful discrimination, and they're areas like food preparation areas or clinical areas. Mm-hmm. And we do ask permission before we take okay. our pups or dogs into areas where there's food being prepared.
Lovely. Yeah. And so that the audience understands as well, a lot of work and care goes into the development, and there is quite an expense as well, isn't there, involved in the training?
There's a lot of expense involved, and we cover all the costs thereof. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's all funded by the public, which mm-hmm. is absolutely wonderful. Mm-hmm. People getting behind this brand and helping us raise mm-hmm. these beautiful pups.
Oh, that's right. It costs beautiful. More than $35,000 and mm-hmm. takes over 2 years to train each and every guide dog puppy. Mm-hmm. And we're so grateful for the support of the community mm-hmm. because each and every one of these guide dog puppies mm-hmm. that you see working mm-hmm. with their users is there as a result of the generosity of people in the community.
That's wonderful, that community yeah. spirit. And obviously this upcoming campaign, or event, should I say rather, Dining in the Dark. Tell us about that. That sounds very exciting.
So Dining in the Dark, as Fred was saying, is an amazing community initiative that allows the public to hold an event at home, so you can have a dinner at home with your friends or at the office mm-hmm. and just hold part of the event blindfolded, so you can experience the challenges of living with vision impairment mm-hmm. But also in a fun and unique way mm-hmm. and ask your guests to donate what they would have spent on a night out to Guide Dogs WA. So you're raising awareness mm-hmm. and having a different and unique challenge but also mm-hmm. making a difference to people living with vision loss and blindness in Western Australia, because we believe that no one should be alone in the dark.
That's wonderful, and it really is a simulation, like you were saying before the show, isn't it? It's giving people a real experience of what it is like, and it's an opportunity for that you know, networking that these two are doing right now. I'm not sure if Hilda's is interested.
That's exactly interested right. Andrew. Yeah, immersing yourself in the experience and having an understanding of something like what our clients go through on a day-to-day basis, except for when you have a Dining in the Dark experience, the blindfold comes off, but for many of our clients, that's not the case. For all of our clients, that's not the case. But by having a good time, having a good night at home or at the office, you get to support little puppies just like Mitchell and Hilda here so that we can train more guide dogs to help our clients.
Lovely. So if I want to host an event, what do I do? Do I have to register online?
Yes, you can go to www.dineinthedark.com.au and you just click register now. There's some really fun videos and resources mm-hmm. on there. We've got games and activities and an instruction booklet. So hosting your event's very easy, very simple. And you just click register now. That's www.dineinthedark.com.au and you can host your event and you can support this fantastic program. Help little puppies like
beautiful.
Mitchell and Hilda make it through their training and support that more than $35,000 that it costs to train them.
Wonderful. And I guess in terms of the guide dogs, how long do they generally work for as well, Andrew?
We like our dogs to work for at least 8 years if we can, mm-hmm. because the dog will be about 2 years of age when it goes out to be matched with a client or one of our consumers. So we like to try and get 8 years working life.
Okay, great. And they're such gorgeous animals. What do they do after they finish their 8 or 9 years? Service.
One of the first prize for us is if the animal can retire with its user mm-hmm. and remain in the home, because that's kind of a nice sort of finality to the working life. But if that doesn't happen, then we, as an organisation, we undertake to place the dog mm-hmm. sensitively in a home where it can go into retirement, so to speak.
Wonderful. Now, Andrew, I've been told that you've had a Dining in the Dark experience in the past. So how about you tell the audience a bit about that experience, what it was like?
When Jess and I talked about this program, Eating in the Dark resonates very strongly with me. Mm-hmm. When I first commenced my career, one of the things that you had to do was spend 24 hours under blindfold, mm-hmm. and that involves eating. Mm-hmm. And I can recall to this day, which is some well over 35 years ago, that event when I sat down to eat a meal with a blindfold on. Yeah. And it's a great leveler, and it gives one an appreciation of what it's like in a very small sense, but in quite a vulnerable sense, because when you eat and you're not confident, it can be quite tricky. Mm. And it's difficult. And I played a couple of jokes on me, and they gave me peas and rice to eat with a fork. And I was chasing pee around my plate, of course, which is hilarious too.
Okay. So it sounds like an experience on an individual level, but also, yes, I guess, interactions with others would also be interesting as well. What about yourself, Jess? Have you been dining in the dark?
I have dined in the dark, and I can tell you it made such a mess. It's very easy to spill a glass of wine when you've got a blindfold on, but it's a fantastic experience. You definitely have a lot of fun. But it also ties into that understanding of the difference that you're making in the community. Mm-hmm. When you have that sense taken away or it's hindered in any way, it's very challenging. As Andrew said, chasing a pea around the plate can be very frustrating if you're hungry, trying to get that fork in your mouth and there's nothing on it. But it's also a fun way to have your friends and family together. When I did it, I almost got nothing in my mouth, and it's very frustrating. But when the blindfold comes off, you have an appreciation of the difference that you're making just by partaking in that one activity.
Wonderful. Well, you're both clearly making a huge difference in the community and the work that you do. So congratulations from us here on the couch. We're always glad to have you, as well as these little critters on here as well. If you'd like to know more about the Dining in the Dark experience, you can go to thecouch.com.au, or just quickly, if you'd like to let us know the registration site again.
That's www.dineinthedark.com.au, and just click register now and you get your free registration pack in the mail and you can host your own event. Thank you so much for your support.
Thank you so much for both of you coming on the couch, and we'll look forward to seeing you again soon, I hope.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you.
Now, if you've missed out any of that information, because I could talk to these guys all day, they're absolutely lovely, go to thecouch.com.au. But if you haven't had a chance to check out the commercial, here it is now.
Like every other job, guide dogs need training. You can help a guide dog get its first job. Sign up for your Dining in the Dark event now at dineinthedark.com.au, because no one should be alone in the dark.
And can I just say, just quickly about that commercial, the guy that did that, Jake Shannon, who's Gary Shannon's son, did that absolutely free, and he's a fantastic director, and we want people to share that out. Put it on your Facebook, put it anywhere you can, get the message out there, Dining in the Dark. The Guide Dogs WA deserve it. Now, if you missed the website for Guide Dogs WA, we've got it up on screen right now. It is, of course, www.guidedogswa.com.au. We want you to support them, even financially, if you can't support Dining in the Dark. And next week, we'll have Aisha coming in. She's a fantastic lady. She's organised an event with 300 people. Don't miss it next week. We'll be back with more of The Couch right after this, only on Foxtel. Welcome back to The Couch here on Foxtel. Hope you're enjoying the show. As part of the show, over the many years, 14 years that we've been doing TV, it's been a pleasure to encourage and promote young people doing some great things in the community. Funny enough, we've got so many young people here in Perth that are just so dedicated to their craft, whether it's music, theatre, arts or politics. Another one here with me today is Amber Reid. She's a fantastic musician. Welcome to The Couch.
It's good to be here.
It's nice to have you here. You're not singing this time around.
Yes.
But I'd love to know a little bit about you, Amber. What gets you going? I mean, how old are you now?
I'm 17 now.
You sang on the show a couple of weeks ago. You were wonderful.
Thank you.
Tell me about your influences in music. Because I said to you a couple of times, you look a bit like Christina Aguilera at times. How does she influence you?
Well, I've always loved Christina's music and just the way she performs, her confidence, her range is amazing. And I saw her when I was really young, and it's just really stuck with me my whole life. And
is there a favourite song?
I love a lot of the stuff she did in Burlesque, and Hurt is a really emotional song she did, but I just love everything.
She's an amazing artist. Now, when did you decide, I want to be a singer, I want to be an artist?
From a really young age, actually.
Did you have a musical family? Or
no, I didn't have a musical family. But I've just been singing ever since I could speak, and it really developed over time, and I entered a few competitions, joined some choirs, and now it's just my passion, I love it.
So have you ever done like X Factor, Australian Idol, The Voice? Have you ever thought of doing that sort of stuff?
I have. When I was really young, they had a children's version of Australian Idol mm-hmm. when I was about 7, and I got into the top 20 of WA, and that really catapulted me into the music scene, and I loved the experience. It was such a good starting experience yep. for me.
So for you, you're studying year 12?
I'm in year 12,
yeah. Year 12, so you're just about to finish at the end of this year.
Yes.
Where to from that? What do you want to do?
Well, I'd really love to be studying some area of music at university next year and in the years to come, whether it's musical theatre or classical voice yep. or contemporary. I really love singing whatever, any genre.
You want to stick with your music. And obviously WAPA would be probably a fit for
yes.
you, studying music. Have you ever thought of what you'd like to do in 5 years' time with your music? Where would you like to be? Would you like to be travelling the world, staying in Perth?
I would like to be travelling. I'd really like to go to America and do some touring. Both sides, and England and Europe, and I think classical is a good way to go for that area, but for my musical theatre, which is what I really, really love, that would be Broadway and the West End.
So. Does anything in the life of music that really disappoints you, lets you down, that you don't like?
Never, never. There's never a dull
you
moment.
Love all things
I love
music.
It. I love it all.
Would you like to be doing theatre, musical theatre, or would you like to do concerts and singing as Amber Reid?
I feel like both ways would be really good pathways. And who's to say that I couldn't do both in the end?
Do you write your own music?
I do. I'd really like to do more of it. Year 12 has kind of bogged me down with study, and I haven't had a lot of time to write music this year, but hopefully next year I can be getting into
now,
more of that.
Now, one thing that captures me about you is you're so down to earth. And I know you like this all the time because I've seen your Bali photos on Instagram. What do you like to do when you're not doing music?
I draw. I may or may not be in a few TV shows. I hang out with friends, and I'm a people person. I like to be around others and just talking, hanging out, going to the movies.
Now, I asked you off air, what would you be doing if you weren't doing music? Is there anything that you could fall back on and say, well, I'll do this? Did you want to be a nurse, a doctor, a lawyer?
Yeah, it's such a hard question because music is such a big passion. But I'm quite interested in law and the idea of social justice, and I'd like to learn a bit more about that in the years to come.
What do you reckon the most important thing that you need is to follow through with your music? Because I know you've got a fantastic mum and dad, that your mum is here all the time and that she's right here in the studio today. She's very supportive, but that she's not a stage mum, which is a good thing.
Yeah.
What's important to you about your music? What do you need to keep you going strong?
I feel like there has to be a really strong sense of passion to get you through. It's a tough business because there are so many people, but if you're passionate about it, and you love it, then that'll get you through.
Well, you're an inspiration to us here on the couch. We're hoping to follow you through to when you become really old and still with us. Not that you'll ever be that old compared to us. But thank you very much. Advice to young people, do you think that they should pursue a career in music, or do you think, like a lot of people are saying to people now, get a job at Coles,
no,
get a job at the...
Definitely.
Yeah, become a teacher.
No, pursue music. If it's what you want to do and you love it, then just go for it.
And when you become a big star, will you always remember the couch?
Definitely.
Would you maybe write a theme for us? I hope Danny Stefanetti's not listening.
Of course, I promise.
Fantastic. Can you give me a bit of Christina Aguilera? I'm impromptu here. I put you on the spot. A little bit of Christina Aguilera for me?
Oh, sometimes I get a good feeling, yeah.
Can I try that? Oh, sometimes I get a good feeling. Funny enough, I do get a good feeling about you. You're going to be a star. You're such a wonderful person. Congratulations so far.
Thank you so much.
Good luck with your exams. Good luck with everything you do with that. Keep that up your sleeve. And we hope to have you back. You're going to perform for us today on the couch at the end. You performed for us at the beginning. It is nice to see you here today. And thanks for spending some time with us.
No worries.
And well done. And do you want
to
just quickly give out your Facebook page, because people are going to want to follow you?
Yes. You can find me on Facebook at Amber Reid. and also on YouTube as well. I have some songs.
Beautiful. That is Amber Reid, everybody. She's a wonderful young teller. She's a good friend of us here at The Couch. We're going to see her hopefully more often if she has the time. She's probably going to be signing autographs outside, and that's just to the crew. If you want more information about Amber Reid or anything you've seen on The Couch today, check out this promo.
If you're looking for more info on anything you've seen on today's show, head to thecouch.com.au. It's where you'll find all the links for our guests, plus clips from the show, backstage photos, and even exclusive movie reviews. You can also sign up as a Couchie and be part of our competitions, including Spin It to Win It. New Zealand viewers, that's open to you too. So jump online and check it out now. thecouch.com.au.
Welcome back to The Couch here on Aurora Television, Foxtel. It gives me great pleasure to welcome back our next presenter. It is, of course, Steve Collins. Haven't seen you for a while. Welcome back.
Thank you very much, Fred. Yes, I've been out and about, travelling the world, having a great time. While you've been sitting there
I
doing
know.
Nothing.
I know, and I went to Alice Springs in
yes,
East Rock for
isn't that
a couple
a great,
of days.
Isn't Alice Springs lovely?
Wonderful time. I'm going to talk more about that later. But what are we going to talk about today? Malaysian Airlines.
I've been up, Malaysian Airlines are rebranding, so I went up to KL recently. Because they've got a new CEO who's German, and they've got a new operations manager who's Irish, and they've got a new marketing manager who's American. So they're really changing the whole culture there.
Why do you believe they've changed the culture?
Well, because 2014 was a very bad year for them.
With the plane crashes,
and it wasn't really handled well. So now they've decided, well, we need to have other opinions. We need to have people who have got a bit more experience in the international airline industry. So they've got these people in, and I've spoken to Christoph Müller, who is the CEO, lovely man. We've got some great ideas from him. So I went up there, and I went up there for SATA. You know, when you have an airline meal, you take it for granted. Well, I went up to their catering division. And that was insane.
Did we take any photos?
I wasn't allowed to take many photos of that,
really?
But I got a video of the guy that peels a fruit and the way he peels mangoes and stuff. Like, so
incredible.
Fast.
So where did they do this, in Malaysia?
They do it at KLIA, at the airport. It's a huge facility. And they make 35,000 meals per day for people with all sort of dietary conditions. A lot of their meats that they get from Australia, so we supply their beef. I think we supply their chicken. They'd go for about 4 tonne of chicken a day because that's the most popular of the meats. And I always thought that it would be sort of like a factory, but it's not. It's very, very hands-on. It's all
Pretty
these chefs,
fresh.
And it's amazing.
Would you fly Malaysian Airlines again? I know you have.
Absolutely. Oh,
you
they're a great airline.
Because I was saying I was a little bit frightened. And
it's a very, very good airline. It's going to change over the next year or so, and they're going to change some of their routings are going to change, so they're going to change their branding and they're going to change the interiors a bit. I also went to their crew, their cabin crew training.
Are these the photos that I saw? Have you got some photos?
Yeah, there you go.
Is that a model plane?
This is there. They've got the mock-ups of all the type of aircraft they've got.
Awesome.
And this is they're learning how to use a galley.
So does it look like a real plane inside?
Yes, it's exactly like the real plane. This is the first class in the A380. We're all sitting there. And this is with the chutes, because you've got to learn how to get there. And that's the lovely Kelsey. She tried it out. And these are the ladies that served us. And I was also a flight attendant for a while there. I had to serve, and I was very, very good. I did spill the champagne, though, unfortunately.
I'm surprised you had any champagne left. Oh, a little for me.
But no, it's really because the thing about the cabin crew is 90% of the job is about safety, and you were talking about safety. Yep. Only 10% of their job is about actually serving food and
which
stuff
is good,
like that.
Isn't
but there's a way to do it, yeah. And
fantastic.
I learned some pretty good tricks about flying.
Yep.
The worst times to fly. The most dangerous time are the 3 minutes upon takeoff and the 7 minutes upon landing.
Do you know what? I'd agree with them, because that's when I feel sick at the beginning and also at the end.
And the thing I learnt was always wear decent shoes. Don't wear high heels, ladies, because if you've got to go in that chute, you'll rip the thing. And the other thing is, and on just on takeoff and landing, just go a little bit tighter, because if you have to escape, you go click. It'll take 1 or 2 seconds if it's loose to get out. As if it's tight, you go click and it's instant.
Do you know when you sit on those seats which are emergency evacuation seats, and they look at us
because I've got long legs,
and they sometimes say you're a little bit overweight. Yeah. Are you going to be able to save all the others? And I said, listen, I always say to them, if there's an emergency, I'd be the first one down that chute.
Well,
Trust me.
Look, they all say, are you happy to help?
Capable?
I say, look, I'm always happy to share that. Follow me, everyone.
And I've been pushing everybody out.
Yeah, exactly
that chute.
Right.
What else did we get?
Now I went to Langkawi and I stayed at the most gorgeous place. It's called the Datai, and it's on the north of Langkawi Island.
Where is Langkawi?
Langkawi's the most northerly part of Malaysia. It's actually 99 islands in the group. I could see an island just offshore, beautiful, which was part of Thailand. But this place is spectacular. It's set among in 47 hectares in a rainforest. That's the pool.
Is that your private villa?
That's the pavilion. That's one of the restaurants. I'll show you my private villa, which will come up in a minute.
Really?
This is just it's all rainforest, and they built this thing using elephants so as not to. Oh, that's the spa.
Where are the
that's
elephants?
Beautiful.
Oh, you mean?
Well,
no.
This is when they built it, and that's it's got its own beach.
Shot?
It's got its own bay. You can go out there. You can go. It's the most gorgeous beach, and then we can get. Going that to get to the villas beautiful. Here. I had a villa. Oh, that's my friend.
Oh, you look
again.
Good in your bases.
I look great, don't I?
Don't people look slimmer in the photos?
Yeah. Now this is a little pathway. That's a villa. You see how it's hidden in the rainforest? Yep. It's just gorgeous. And that's a little pathway.
Is that where you stayed?
I stayed in one of those. I stayed in one of those villas. That was my villa there. It's gorgeous. Oh, you've got two rooms. You've got a great big bedroom, living room, which has got an immense table. Look at that bathroom. That's a lovely bath. You know the best thing about that, though, is the shower. The shower is very high. It's over 3 metres. It's got a height of over 3 metres, and it falls. And when
is
you
it
stand
one of those
under
big
it,
ones?
Yeah, it's huge. Oh. And when it falls, it's like standing under a waterfall because it's such a large drop. The water drops get bigger and it's just the most amazing.
Is it
thing.
An outdoor shower or one of those?
No, it's an indoor shower. Okay. The bathroom is good. All the ladies are having baths because it's a big, deep bath. But the food there, they've got an Australian executive chef who's doing wonderful things with the food. It's beautiful. You're in the rainforest. You think that there's no one else around because each villa is surrounded by rainforest. It's got a great spa, its own beach. The food is actually absolutely brilliant. But the thing is, because it's in a rainforest, you've got all these animals around you. You've got two types of monkeys. You've got wild boars. You've got all these incredible birds. You've got the colugo. Now, the colugo is the world's only flying monkey. It's a big thing. It's like a big flying fox. Yeah.
Do they
and you
still
only
eat
find
bananas?
Them in a few places, eh?
They eat bananas still?
I don't know what they eat.
They eat anything they like.
But they've also got Langkawi's. Yep. Got more butterflies, species of butterflies in Australia.
Yep.
And when you're there, they encourage them. And everywhere you sit there, there's all those. You sit under your balcony, there's little butterflies flying around. It is
good
beautiful.
Place to go to for a holiday.
Datai is excellent.
How
if
would you
want
get there?
Well, I would fly up to Langkawi via KL, probably. You've got to fly up there. I'd go Malaysian Airlines, actually, because it's really good. But it's the most gorgeous, gorgeous spot, the Datai. It's really pure luxury. You just sit there and each villa has got its own little iPod and Bose sound system. You sit there.
Anything else you want to say quickly? Because I just want to tell you about my Alice Springs.
No, you tell me about Alice Springs.
Well, yeah. Now that you asked me, thank you. I did. I went to Alice Springs. Have you been there?
Yes, it's lovely.
You have been?
It's gorgeous.
Well,
I love it there.
I went to Uluṟu as well.
You went
have
to
you
Uluṟu.
Ever climbed Uluṟu?
No, I haven't climbed Uluṟu.
Check this out. I've got the proof that I actually did it. Hey, look. There you go. There's Uluṟu.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I can see that. That looks a bit. Yes, that's you.
The proportions are a bit out.
Did they?
Look at me. Oh,
yeah.
They had to track me on GPS or something.
Yeah,
like
the GPS. Yeah.
GPS. Yeah. So picked me up on the blimp thing.
Of course. Yeah.
And Google Air was there as well. But do you know what? If you haven't been to Alice Springs, folks, I have to say I thoroughly enjoyed the 4 days I was there. Wouldn't want to stay more than 4 days. It's very expensive. But this is Alice Springs. This is what I did.
Is this from
Anzac? 20 seconds.
Oh, wait a minute. Aurora. Yeah. Oh,
there's me eating. Yeah. Me looking at signs. Me going back to my room. Me looking at
the emus. Yeah. Me in a bus.
Driving.
Me. Oh, look. There's Uluṟu, which you club. You there, driving.
Yeah, me driving again.
That's great.
There's Uluṟu.
Did you have a little bit of champagne while you were
there? I did.
At
night, at sunset, we had cheesels and champagne.
Cheesels and champagne.
That's lovely.
Cheesels
that's
and champagne.
Cheap.
Oh, I did.
Cheesels.
Cheesels are fantastic.
But you know what?
I like cheesels, but not when you're having champagne.
All the Japanese people are saying, oh, arigato.
You know what you like? You would know what you like about the Datai. Datai. When you have breakfast, you get a breakfast cocktail. I was having breakfast Bellinis.
Oh,
that's a great
and you
way
lay
to
down for the rest of the day, I bet.
Absolutely not. It got me up. Going.
Tell
going.
Us about Radio Roaming.
Radio Roaming, it's on iTunes Radio. It's on the TuneIn Network, all these other
What's
networks.
What's your website?
It's called radioroaming.com, as a matter of fact. And you hear all my travel stuff on there.
Sounds fantastic. You know where we're travelling to next?
No idea at this stage, but I'll figure out when I'm told.
Wonderful. And I don't know if we've got time. Have we got Uluṟu up as well? We actually went to a place that everybody thought it was Ayers Rock.
Yes.
We all stopped, and it was really amazing. Oh, there it is.
That
there.
Does look like
from
Uluṟu,
a distance. It looks
like
Uluṟu. Everybody was stopping
it's
and taking
on
photos.
Top. Did not know anybody notice. It's
We'd
flat.
Never
it's,
been there before, so we got
it's
fooled.
It's a plateau.
Right?
Look,
there you go.
It's a tepui, they call them in Venezuela.
Thank you very much,
Thank
Steve
you very
Collins.
Much.
We'll listen out for 6 PR okay. as well, because you'll be there as well. Neesha Seth. Thank you for coming back, being so patient with us. UN Day, tell us about that quickly.
So United Nations Day is the 24th of October every year, but mm-hmm. this year it's pretty exciting because it's the 70th
yes.
anniversary.
And what are they doing to celebrate?
So we're having a formal affair at the Government House Ballroom mm-hmm. on Friday the 23rd of October. So if you can come down, you just need to have a look there on the screen. There's some details via our tribe booking link that will also be on the couch.com.
Friday the 23rd of October.
That's
Tickets
it.
Are available now. You can call this number, contact us, or go to Ticketek.
Gosh, you can tell you're a radio
thank you very
host
much.
As well.
Why aren't we celebrating the 97th anniversary of the Treaty of Versailles? That's what I want to know.
Well, you can absolutely come and talk to people about that at the event if you like.
Why is this for? What are we going to be doing on the night?
Very important night. We've got Her Excellency, Honourable...
The Governor?
The Governor, Miss Kerry Sanderson, opening. Yeah. And we've got Andrea Gleeson, the WA State Director of DFAT. Importantly, they're going to be talking about the accomplishments of the United Nations in the past 70 years for the 70th mm-hmm. anniversary, and also what we need to focus on moving forward, so the Sustainable Development Goals as
and
well.
And why is United Nations so important? Why do we... I know we think, oh, it's nothing to do with us. Why do we need to take heed and listen in? Why is this important?
I think in the world we live in today, we come from a multitude of different cultures, we're in different generations, we work in different professions. It's really important to understand how our individual behaviours, group behaviours across cultures interact. Mm-hmm. And the United Nations Association and WA run a lot of events that assist in getting people to, I guess, increase their education in those
Wonderful.
Different spaces.
UN Day, 23rd of October. The website
yes.
address again is?
Website address, if you go to www.unaa/wa.org.au and also look out for Turning the Lights UN Blue, the campaign run by DFAT. There'll be a number of buildings coloured in blue over United Nations Day
Wonderful.
Around the world.
Thank you very much, Neesha. Thank you very much to
Pleasure.
Steve. Thanks to everybody for working on the show today. We need to leave you. Amber Reid is going to perform for us. She's got an awesome song. Let me tell you what it is. Good Reflections. We'll see you next week on Reflections. We've gone over time. We'll see you next week on The Couch. Only on Foxtel. Bye-bye.
Look at me, you may think you see who I really am, but you never know me. Every day, it's as if I play a part. Now I see that if I wear a mask, I can't fool the world, but I cannot fool my heart. That girl I see staring straight back at me. When will my reflection show who I am inside? I am now in a world where I have to hide my heart and what I believe. But somehow I will show the world what's inside my heart and be loved for who I am. Who is that girl I see staring straight back at me? Why is my reflection someone I don't know? Somehow I cannot hide who
first